because what we have before us is not an energy policy, it's an energy non-policy. When I was in college, gas was 25 cents a gallon. And I remember driving my car into those gas stations, and there would be a kid who would be my age or younger coming out and filling up my tank and cleaning the windshields and checking the oil and the tires, and then they gave me either a plate or a towel for showing up. I then went to Europe for 2 years, and when I came back, the oil embargo had hit. No one came out to help me. Everything was self-service. No one gave me any more towels or dishes, and the gas prices in that embargo era was going up to the astounding almost $1.40 a gallon, which we could not believe. And our new president at the time put on a sweater, started a fire in the fireplace, and came before the American people and told us basically, get used to it. Live with less. Take it as an honor to be cold in the dark. That's the process. Fortunately, this country didn't go along with that, nor did the industry go along with that. And instead of being a country in which we were dependent upon OPEC countries, 60 to 70% of our energy coming from OPEC, and I'm sorry, that is not what an Irish chicken does, that is a cartel, that is a cartel that was very against the interests of the United States. Instead of being that which was in the position to be bullied not by a major power, but a secondary power, into thinking they could extort this country, into changing our foreign policy simply by exploiting our energy vulnerabilities, well, America changed. And instead, we decided that would not be our policy. And we came up with a process of not only expanding our energy production in the United States, but we expanded it in a way that produced energy more efficiently, that used it in a cleaner fashion, that used a smaller footprint to do it, that made us energy independent to the point that we could actually be, instead of an importing country, an exporting country in the concept of energy, and that that energy was used not only to support the United States' independence, but also to support our allies and be able to confront negative forces like Russia, which was using energy as a political weapon and still would like to use energy as a political weapon. And now we're faced with three bills here today, one much different than the other two, but the end result of the Democrat vision of energy presented to us in this Energy Week is basically to use the rearview mirror and take us backwards 50 years into the past, where we go back to the time when our economy was fragile and our enemies thought they could take advantage of our energy in our energy dependency, and they could do that to bully the United States. That is not what the process should be in creating an energy future for this particular country. Like, we have three bills that will be for us today. None of them are scientifically grounded. All of them are actually political, paying off political experts, taking science and basically throwing it in the trash and saying, okay, which you can do, you got the votes to do it, but don't have the audacity to stand up and say this administration or this side of the aisle doesn't believe in science because these are politically motivated particular issues. There is no logic to what we're doing. In our committee, it was wonderful. We had the entire committee on the same day that the first bill was voted out, also voting for LWCF. Everyone loved Land and Water Conservation Fund, so that we wanted to make this permanent, and we wanted to triple the amount of money that we were putting into that fund. At the same time we voted to triple the amount of money in that fund, we also voted for bills that would basically cut the revenues from those areas that actually produce the money to go into the fund in the first case, and we call that logical. I call this hypocrisy as well, because there is the vested interest, as the majority here was saying, that governors in their state should have the ability to make decisions on federal waters that are not within the boundaries of their state. But at the same breath, saying that governors in the interior states should not have the ability to have decisions made on federal lands within our state. I'm sorry, that's pure hypocrisy. This is a lack of focus. It's a lack of focus when a year ago the Democrat leadership asked the president to find a way to cut down the cost of energy, oil, and gas, to use his personal contacts to cut down the ability of cut down the cost of that. And then we're bringing bills in here today which will drive up the cost, which will cut down our possibility of doing that in the future. You can do it, but there's a hypocrisy to that very essence of what's going on. Fortunately, the three bills that will be thrown out here today by the Democrats as their policy will have the net effect of destroying jobs, of harming our economy, potentially turning us into an economic tailspin. That can happen. But more importantly, it's nice to have a visual contrast. Because this morning, Republican leaders, led by Mr. Scalise and Ms. Cheney and several others, introduced a comprehensive energy package, an energy package that is for all energy, all of the above, both fossil fuel and alternative, one that actually will grow our economy, which will create more jobs, will give a logical standard of what we should do going forward with a clear view. The clear view of what Republicans would like to do with having a logical, comprehensive approach is in vast contrast to three disjointed, dispirited, non-scientific bills that simply want to pay off political communities. With that, Mr. Chairman, I reserve the balance of my time.